strange.
5 seconds. Good evening and welcome to the Conscious Life Expo. How you doing? Is this not wonderful that the whole spiritual family comes together?
Yay!
We're looking at spirituality, metaphysics, the esoteric sciences, holistic health, all of these wonderful things to expand your mind, your awareness, your consciousness, and turn it around and give it to others. Today we got the General Motors of the band business, the metaphysical business, the prophecy business, the earth sciences business, predictions, UFOs, angels, and extraterrestrials. Nothing else need to be said. This one's gonna be a blast. Welcome, Sean David Morton.
Should I move this further this way? Would this be better?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Oh, much better. Yes.
Yeah.
All right. No feedback. All right, kids. I'm sorry we got a little bit. We got started a little bit late. You might want to turn the game on that just a touch. I'll try to talk over it as much as I can. So. But again, on top of it. Sorry, we're just having some sound issues here. You can hear me. I can probably just talk like this, but that's all right. Okay, you got me? Okay, let's get started. Please come in. Please have a seat. We're already running late. I hate starting late, but obviously the other person went late, so, and I'm sorry we crammed you all in the hallway out there. Yes, and Mark is waiting to get to the Grammys, so. All right, let's just, I'm going to try to deal with some solutions. We're going to try to do some stuff. We've got a lot of very interesting things coming up. Also, I believe that monologues are dictatorial and ultimately fascist and lead to Republican administrations. So if you have any questions whatsoever, please just raise your hand. There's no stupid questions, just stupid people that ask them. No, stupid answers. No. Anything you've got, we're going to try to put something together here. Little fun and games, a couple of jokes, a little old Irish wisdom here, and cobble together some future. Based upon everything from the ancient Egyptians to the Mayans and the Aztecs to my humble projections of what it is I see. We're going to try to talk about solutions actually in the first part, so while you guys are awake, so I should have you for about 20 minutes of awake time, we're going to talk about a couple of things. First thing we're going to solve, let's cure cancer, okay? What do you say we do that first? All right, curing cancer is a good thing. First off, the reason I wrote this down on the board here, if you guys actually want to write it down, www.brobryomed.com. BryoMed.com. One second. Erase the R on that. Because I need the board for a lot of other things. So it's you guys can write this down. BryoMed.com. This is a website on an amazing new cancer modality that I've actually personally seen work. As many of you know, just to give you a little bit of background. My family was our pioneers in the alternative cancer business. My stepfather, Frank Salomon, was responsible for setting up a number of clinics in Tijuana. He set up the Genesis West Clinic, the Good Samaritan Clinic, Clinic of Seidel. He worked with the Contreras brothers. We worked with Dr. Rodrigo Rodriguez, who actually has another one. I'll give you another website here. It's also very interesting. IBCHospital.com. www.ibchospital.com. The reason I'm giving you some of these is because pancreatic cancer has been virtually pandemic. Liver cancer has been pandemic. The kidney cancer, along with massive rises in the last 10 years in specifically Alzheimer's, Parkinson's. A lot of that I think has to do with the chemtrails, cell phone radiation. A lot of that is what they're not telling you all. Flu pandemics that are happening across the United States. Each flu season, we're losing between 36 and 50,000 people that they're not actually telling you about, mostly young kids under the age of 12 and older people over the age of 65. There are emergency clinics across the United States each flu season that are literally filled to the brim, and it never seems to make the national news. Just to give you an idea, we lost 50,000 people in the Vietnam War, and we're losing that many people just to flu epidemics actually each year. So we started a lot of cancer movement in the early part of the 1970s. We started something called the Committee for Freedom of Choice in Cancer Therapy. My late mother, who just died back in August, was head of the National Health Federation for 27 some odd years. I had two very dear friends, a man who was like a foster grandfather to me, and my mother both died of pancreatic cancer just within the last year. The challenge is that my mother, who was on another, I'll give you one other treatment here that I think is also very interesting that you'll hear a lot about and you can look. If you like, it's hard to write on this board here. The treatment's actually called Escazole, and you'll be hearing a lot more about it because as they're doing tests on it, as they're doing clinical studies, Escazole is also known as blue scorpion venom. Anybody heard of this recently? Blue scorpion venom. Yes. My mother was on the blue scorpion venom. She felt she had her cancer beat. She went with a rather nefarious friend on vacation to France. Treatment, the cancer came roaring back. In my friend Dan McPeak's case, we were actually down in El Salvador, actually took him to El Salvador, took him to Mexico, and the Breal Mixol I saw on the charts with the medical records, I watched his pancreatic cancer shrink to the point of where they couldn't even find it on a CAT scan. And what eventually wound up killing him is he checked into a hospital, and the morphine and fentanyl that they were actually giving him burned holes in his esophagus and his lower intestine, and basically his guts just kind of leaked into his in the rest of his guts, if you will. And it was the doctors that got a hold of him that eventually killed him, but the treatments that we had him on were working. Now, the Breal Mixol is something that's revolutionary because Breal Mixol, a lot of this stuff is being developed right now in Cuba. So here we have Fidel Castro, who's one of the bloodiest dictators in history, who now happens to be sitting on probably one of the most advanced medical establishments in the history of man. And so what he's been doing, and let me just explain a couple of the things that have been going on. The Escazole, which is the most interesting of this, Escazole can be taken as a drink. It's literally diluted. The story behind this was there was a man in Cuba who was dying of cancer. He was drinking tequila on his porch, figuring he didn't have much else to lose. He fell through a hole in his porch up to about his chest, and he fell into a nest of these little rather nasty, irascible blue scorpions who began to just sting the snot out of this guy. And by the time his family found him, he was all swelled up from the stings from the scorpions. They took him to the hospital. When the swelling went down, the man's cancer had been removed. And this remarkable thing was is that they then went back, got the blue scorpions, began to milk the blue scorpions, started mixing the blue scorpion venom just with regular water and saline solution, and they discovered that the blue scorpion venom is a very, very powerful neurotoxin. And one of the things that they're doing now, and there's a big special actually on PBS, which was called The Venom Cure. I'm not sure if anybody's seen this. It's called The Venom Cure. It's in DVD form. You can actually call PBS and actually ask for it. It was a two-hour show that was all about recent research into spider venom, scorpion venom, snake venom, etc., being used for clinical research. So in the blue scorpion venom case, they discovered that in a diluted form, this venom gets into the body's neural system and lights up the body's immune system like a Christmas tree, and so kickstarts the immune system of the body and then cuts off the communication of the body to the cancer cell. Hence, the cancer cell turns kind of a gray color and actually then begins to. Now, in the case of a rather more interesting and I think in some ways more effective treatment for this, there's a new chemical called Breal Mixol. And Breal Mixol, write that down too. Breal Mixol. This is where you can get it from briomed.com. Breal Mixol is now being used by a doctor named Dr. Fernando Basail at a clinic in El Salvador. It has been legalized in what's known as the C5 countries throughout Central America. And what they're doing with the Breal Mixol is they're injecting the Breal Mixol directly into the cancer tumors. And by the way, for people with leukemia, they actually simply inject it into the directly into the bloodstream. And this has been one of the most effective cures or controls, should I say, because the cancer will come back if it's not directly treated. But one of the most direct, one of the most effective cures that I've actually seen with my own eyes, where I watched the cancer go from this big to microscopic. Doctors couldn't find it on a CAT scan, only to watch my friend then be killed by modern medical science when he actually came home and was checked into the hospital and eventually died of an infected catheter port, the fentanyl and the morphine burning the holes in his esophagus and his intestines. So basically modern medicine wound up killing him. Another interesting thing is, and this has a lot to do with the future as well, and tonight, by the way, on the television, or was it tonight or was it last Thursday? I'm sorry, I must have watched it on TiVo. But they're doing stories on the news talking about the miracle cures south of the border, how so many people are actually going down to Tijuana and actually getting treatment down in Tijuana. Well, one of the clinics down in Tijuana that my family set up with Dr. Rodrigo Rodriguez is International Biocare, ibchospital.com. It is a fantastic clinic actually in TJ. Dr. Rodrigo Rodriguez is a doctor of nuclear medicine. Dr. Fernando Basail, the gentleman that runs the clinic in El Salvador, actually has his medical degree from UC here in the United States, and went to Central America specifically because there was more freedom to treat people with actual cures there than there was here in the US, as many of you know, that if you cure cancer here, you pretty much wind up in jail because anything that works, you know, gets you tossed in the pokey. So the reason I'm talking about this is because one of the greatest future trends that we're looking at is the baby boomers becoming the aging boomers, if you will. That the baby boomers, the people born between 1945 and about 1965, are now turning 65. And so with this, within the next 5 years, we're going to have almost 80 million people in the United States all turning 85 years old. We, in fact, have the oldest population and the youngest population because suddenly, for whatever reason, we started to reproduce again right around 1985. So we've got about 80 million aging people, and we've got about 60 plus million younger people all born after 85, all coming along to take their place. So the answer is that the large insurance companies, specifically Blue Cross, Blue Shield, Kaiser Permanente, the very, very big insurance companies are now building gigantic hospitals directly across the border in Tijuana. What I've seen with my own eyes there is the first of a row of hospitals that's being built is called, I guess that's really necessary. I feel like I'm OJ or something. if it doesn't fit, you must acquit. The first of these hospitals is a gleaming edifice of marble and cherry wood, and it looks like a Hollywood set. And it's about 15 stories, two towers, and it's called the Hospital of Angels down in Tijuana. And the Hospital of Angels specifically is the first of almost a dozen brand spanking new state-of-the-art hospitals that they're actually building in a row directly along the Rio Grande, just the other side of TJ, and just the other side of the border there. So the next wave is going to be that you'll be able to go to Tijuana and actually use your US insurance card to be able to get treatment there. And as of now, Blue Shield and Blue Cross are actually accepting their insurance at this hospital in TJ. And that's gonna be the next big wave. You know why? Because you're paying US premiums, then you go to Mexico and you actually get the care for 80% cheaper. Here's the real challenge. The challenge is, and I mean no prejudice when I say this, just that Mexico's kind of a third world country, they have state-of-the-art equipment there, like 1.5 Tesla MRI machines. Unfortunately, they have rather uneducated Mexicans working these machines. So the challenge becomes is that you have nursing staff that do all the work. I mean, they do bedpans, they change, you know, the same woman that's changing your bed and changing the sheets and is the maid is also the person that's giving your IV. So the challenge is that they obviously pay less down there, but you kind of get what you pay for. The wave is going to be for these clinics outside the United States as the U.S. seems to be exchanging populations. The one hand, people flooding in from Mexico, and on the other hand, you've got all these people retiring to Mexico, so we're just kind of trading places into Baja as they come here and we go there. So this is going to be the next big wave medically, and the reason I figure, well, let's cure cancer, because so many people are talking to me about this. I've been at this, since the early 70s when I was 16 years old. The minute I got my driver's license, my family had me driving people back and forth across the border, almost like an underground railroad, if you will, of people that had cancer that couldn't get treated properly here in the United States that were going to clinics down in Mexico. So we started with our first clinic down there, which was the Good Samaritan Clinic, and there's been a lot of other clinics since then, but we've been pioneers in this. So when I tell you that I saw something work with my own eyes, specifically the Briomixol, also what we're trying to do is also get licensed here in the United States for the Briomixol to be taken as a food supplement. And if you can take this as a food supplement, what this is that it's an autoimmune booster. So generally, you can actually get shots or pills or sublinguals or whatever that you can take every day that will basically guard you against the plethora of diseases and things out there. Okay, so it cured cancer. Yes, quick question. Yes.
What was the autoimmune booster?
The Briomixol. Briomixol is the name of it. It's what it is. I should describe what it is. It comes from Brazil. Actually, it's being used in the clinics in El Salvador, and it is a combination of rain. It's a type of Amazonian cactus. With some mixed with a certain types of bark, actually. So it's considered a homeopathic. So it's not a drug. It's completely natural. And the Briomixol is being used now to up immune response and treat cancer. When they inject it directly into the cancer, a course of treatments. And the nice thing about this is, for example, if anybody's interested in actually going down to the clinic in El Salvador, it's a beautiful resort clinic on the beach. 10 days of treatment in a state-of-the-art facility that has rotating Tesla MRI machines, best of the best. The place was just built last year. Is 10 days of full treatment, doctor treatment with tests and everything else is $6,000 for 10 days, which includes room, board, food, the whole thing. $6,000. And then, pardon me?
Where?
The clinic. Is, and that's why I gave you the website. The website, look at bryomed.com is the website. And it's actually, it's a clinic in San Salvador. By the way, they speak English. The US dollar is the form of currency in El Salvador. They're very friendly towards tourism. And they also give you a 90-day supply. You go down there for the 10 days, and they give you a 90-day supply to actually bring home with you so you can actually treat yourself here. You can actually bring it into the country because if you have a doctor's prescription there, under what was known as the Bohannon decision with the 10th Circuit Court back in 1977, you can bring medical prescriptions with a doctor's prescription in from outside the United States. So you can bring the Escazole in too as well. Actually, Escazole, if you contact us, we can actually get you from Tijuana and you can actually use here, but that's for people that suffer from cancer. So most people know people that suffer from cancer. You're a very connected group. I try to give you cutting edge information because I figure for every person in here, you're very, very well networked into thousands upon thousands of people that you know. You know, people that come to these shows have big mouths and they love to talk about what's going on, right? So that's why we love you. All right, so that's the cure for cancer. That's number one. Number two, what else were we talking about? Let me just pitch some minor things to you here, and then we'll get to some dates and times and places and all that. First off, a couple of things. Let me just give you the pitch. We've got a resort coming up. Got an actual thing coming up in Mount Shasta, September 7th to 10th. This is going to be a lot of fun. We're actually going to do a sweat lodge. We're going to do a remote viewing training weekend. We're going to go do some spelunking in some caves. There's all kinds of great things going on. You have your flyer there. So this is the Mount Shasta Resort. I don't know if I'm going to bring my cat Shaloo or not. That's him. Very handsome cat, isn't he? He's a very handsome boy. My cat Shaloo on my shoulder there. It's also my was joking. That's my high school graduation picture there. So thank you, Mark. So there you go. There's also information about the retreat on the back. That's number one. Number two, what do we have here? Oh, we have, once again, being at the cutting edge of the of kind of the health field movement with a lot of this, there's a fantastic new company out, which is called the Liquidity International. This is a startup company that just got started about a year or so ago. This is run by the McKnight family, who manufacture for 11 different brands. They're the manufacturing company that they relabel. We've actually got a trip to Hawaii going on there. You put them back in the bowl if you give us some information. But Liquidity International, these liquidity products are fantastic. There's a Noni juice product. Anybody ever drink Noni juice? Doesn't it taste like the devil's own spunk, this stuff? I mean, it's just like, I can't imagine how the Samoans get so big drinking that crap. But they actually have a Noni juice that actually tastes really good because it's mixed with blueberries and some other things. It's one of the best Noni juices, and I have it every morning. And I'm 87 years old. So anyway, Liquidity International, we got some great stuff. We've got the lovely Miss Melissa back there, and Miss Anna, and Mr. Steve, and they'll tell you all about it. Okay. Last but not least, you want to solve all your money problems? You want to do that? Okay. All right. This is not a pitch. I will tell you what I am doing specifically. For many, many years, since I first started publishing the Delphi Associates Newsletter, I've been involved in the stock market. I've been involved in, I have a hit ratio picking stocks and trends that is out of sight. I think since just when I decided to market, I made a series of predictions on Coast to Coast AM with George Norrie in July of 2005 or so. I told George to actually track a couple of the stocks if he wanted to. And within 1 year, we had a 387% profit ratio in 1 year, specifically with just the stocks that I predicted on the radio and in my newsletter. To give you an example, some of the stocks that I talked about a stock called Nutricia. Company which is NTRZ.OB. Nutricia started when I first recommended it at 60 cents. It closed on Friday at 273, and that's in less than a year. It's quadrupled. 2004, I talked about Disney stock. Disney stock's now up 50%. 2004, I told people to buy Apple. As far back as 2002 to 2003, I said there was going to be this funny little device called an iPod that was going to come out. It was going to revolutionize the music business, and I told people to buy Apple. Apple's up something like 500%. So all these stocks that I've been talking about, including my gold and metals predictions, last year on Norrie's program, I said that gold would hit a high sometime in the May 2006 period. Actually, I said between May and June, that would hit a high of 725. Gold hit a high of 729, actually, and then went straight down in a perfect parabola back to about 525 or so and is on its way back up. Some of my more spectacular predictions have been in copper. Copper is quadrupled. I talked about at that time. to see that we see silver at approximately, I think it was like $7.50 a share by Labor Day. Then I said it would be at $9 a share by Christmas. On Christmas Day of last year, I'm sorry, of 2005, I'm sorry, Christmas Day of 2005, silver was actually 901. So I actually hit it on the nose 6 months in advance. Now, with these stock market predictions, so many people have been begging me to put together some kind of investment club. And I was reluctant to do anything like that simply because I'm not a broker, I'm a gifted amateur. What I do is that I remote view stocks specifically. I see where they're gonna go. I also look for what the next trend is going to be. I know what the next trend is going to be by studying what's going on astrologically, by meditating on the world, by knowing where people's consciousness is going to be going. And I find companies that are actually there to service the trend, if you will. So what I started doing is that in my newsletter, I kept giving stock predictions. People were making dollars off my predictions, obviously. But at the same time, I wasn't really telling them when to sell or when to get out of things. I mean, it was very, very uncontrolled. So what I started doing is last March, a friend of mine asked me to start using my remote viewing on the foreign exchange markets. Now, the foreign exchange markets, for those of you that may or may not know what it is currency trading. You're actually trading currency, betting one currency against another. And what we did is we opened up a virtual account of $1 million, and then we just started goofing around with it. And what I started doing is that every Sunday, I would take a blank graph, and I would take a whole series of these blank graphs. I would remote view and project myself out a week forward and then use my ability to scan energy, if you will. Sometimes I would use a pendulum, just sometimes I would use my hand, and I would actually do like, we call it automatic drawing, if you will. But I would sit with the chart and the graph and I would feel where the energy on the chart and the graph would be, and I would draw a series of lines taking where the currency was at, say on that Friday, starting there, and then draw it throughout the week on a blank chart and graph. I would do anywhere between 5 and 9 of these. I would then send them to my trader, who actually has a desk in Burlington, Vermont. He would put these up on the wall, and he would look at them, and this would be a precursor, a forecast, if you will, like a weather chart of, you know, today's going to be sunny, tomorrow's going to be cold, tomorrow's going to be whatever, and they would then take place bets on currencies. Well, within the course of March, April, May, June, within the course of about 4 months, goofing around with this, we booked a 250% profit. And of course, we were doing some cowboy things with, you know, Monopoly money, but we decided, well, 1st of June, let's put something together. So we got a group of people together. We invested about $35,000 initially. And the minute I opened it up to people, and I just mentioned, I think once in my newsletter, I just said, I'm starting an investment club of some people, and we're going to get a bunch of people together. We're going to trade in a pool, and I'm going to start using my psychic abilities to trade the foreign exchange market. And we're starting a little company, which we called Psychic Financial Investing, or PFI, Sci-Fi Investing. And it is currently the largest and most successful use of psychic abilities to predict the markets, period, that's ever been attempted. What's now happened is that in just a little over 6 months, we've now booked almost a 150% profit on the fund. And specifically, we now have three accounts, soon to have accounts. We have three accounts right now that are worth about $4.5 million. So, and this just comes from a group of our friends and family. We haven't advertised this at all. We haven't said anything really about it other than my mentioning it in the newsletter. And so what I put here is that we just put a chart for our latest account, and it actually shows that what we have on the chart, we opened Magic 8 Ball Distributing LLC, or Inc., I'm sorry, this one. And this just shows trading from 12/21/06, but it already shows, and we were just kind of slacking off in a lot of December. So this only really represents less than 6 weeks of trading, but we've already showed a 10% profit in less than 6 weeks. So this just gives you an idea of this. We are making a very steady 1% per day, 4 days a week on these accounts. So if you add that up to 4% on average, between 3 and about 5%, you average that out, it's pretty cool. And one of the reasons why I did this for my friends and family, a couple of things happened. About 6 months ago, there was a federal ruling where the Securities and Exchange Commission was trying to regulate hedge funds and investment. They got slapped down by the United States Federal District Court, actually in the District of Columbia, that said the SEC could not regulate investment clubs or hedge funds, which opened it up for a lot of us to do what it is we're doing. That's the first thing. The second thing was with foreign exchange, because it was trading in a pool, and because I was doing the projections, and because my traders were working with the cash, it meant that with the foreign exchange markets, it's a whole different ball of wax. The reason being is that foreign exchange, the markets are going to become so volatile later this year because of what's going on with the dollar, and I'm going to talk about that tonight. With what's going on is that the stock market simply wasn't safe. What you're dealing with in the stock market right now is what I call a Jenga economy. Anybody play Jenga? You guys know what Jenga is? So here's what's happening with the stock market. The stock market is flat like this. And what's happening is that all of these mega companies at the top are now buying up all the other companies on the side. So what's happening with the economy is the economy is doing this, whereas the stock market is going up. And you will see the stock market break 13,000 this year. As the stock market starts going up, less and less companies are actually driving the market up. Does that make sense? So the 13,000 stock market is going to be driven by literally less than 30 companies owning everything, which is good for nobody. And so what happens is this Jenga economy, when everything starts to go straight up, you have no support or infrastructure actually supporting the tower, which makes it that much easier to just knock the whole thing over. So if we're looking at a major dollar currency collapse, with the stock market, I was predicting particular stocks or metals or commodities. The difference is the stock market's like farming. You have your plant, your little crop of corn or whatever it is you have. You go and you plant it out in a field. The challenge is that then you have to worry about, is a crow going to come and eat it? Is it going to rain enough? Is it going to be too hot? Is the government going to take your land away? You know, are all these things going to happen to your farm? Doesn't matter how good your plant is. All these things have to happen around it in order to make the market thrive, in order to make your stock go up or down. Foreign exchange vesting is more like gunslinging. I can literally walk into a town with six guns, if you will, say that currency is going to go up against that currency and actually book wins, which means that we can make a great deal of money in a very short period of time. So the reason I set this up, primarily for my friends here in Los Angeles, is I have a lot of friends who are artists. They're actors, they're writers, they're directors, they're musicians. And of course, that is, you get paid a lot of money kind of up front for one thing, and then you have a lot of lag or downtime. So this way, we started the investment account, people invested in the LLC, it's transferred into a foreign exchange account offshore because it's in Canada. We work with Man Financial Canada, and the money's all liquid, so you can get any or all of your money back within 5 days. We just need notice to notify the bank. Any questions on that? So, yes, Gigi. Oh, we'll actually get the paper back here, and we're available. We've got phone numbers, we've got emails, and you can talk to us. Yes, Gigi, we got a question in the back. No, there's no minimum. My request to people, that you give me enough money to help you. So the average was, a lot of people were coming in with, say, they started with five first, found out it went great and actually invested more. The idea, 5,000, yeah. So the idea was, with about a $10,000 investment, that makes about, on average, anywhere between 150 and about 375 a week. So that's rent, you know. And the idea was, with that kind of money, if you're making 1% per day, even with the do for because we do all the work, and we're trading the market 24 hours a day from Sunday through Friday. We've got like four guys who work in 6 hour shifts from Sunday all the way through, and so they're trading from 4 a.m. in the morning almost virtually around the clock, which means you're also getting four times more trading than you would with a regular FX investor. If a regular FX guy was to make a client 10% in a month or 5% even, they'd make that guy president of the company. And with my contacts in intelligence community and knowing what's going on and knowing what's happening, those contacts have been able to tell me what currencies are going to go up and what's going to go down. So that's been the advantage of knowing a lot about this. So it has to do with not only the remote viewing aspect of it, which I'm very good at, but we're managing to book wins virtually. And actually, the only loss we actually took in the account happened on Thanksgiving when we weren't supposed to be trading and the trader had some positions open that he didn't close. And it was what was known as the Thanksgiving Day massacre, when China, Iran and England all started attacking American currency all at once, and you saw the British pound sterling move almost 2,800 pips in 5 days. You saw the euro move almost 3,800 pips in five. It was crazy. I mean, it's just crazy. It led to, and this leads into a lot of the other things I'm talking about. It led to the United States sending the Secretary of the Treasury, the Federal Reserve Chairman, all to China, because the Chinese, you guys read about this in the news, the Chinese were going to dump $1 trillion on the world market. Now, let me tell you a little funny story. This is what you're seeing now. Excuse me. What you're seeing now, the war in Iran and everything that's going on is now the physical manifestation of what's been happening in the foreign exchange markets. I said from the beginning, almost a year ago, that this is what we call the dollar wars. That what was happening is that, and I know this is the dull part of this, but let me explain to you. Let me build up to what happened over Thanksgiving, because I think it's very interesting and it's relevant to the United States possibly attacking Iran in a couple of months. Here's how it went down. What happened was is that in March of 2006, the Federal Reserve took the Federal Reserve note off what's known as the M3 index. Now, the M3 index is an index that shows you how much money is actually in circulation. And this gives us an idea as to how to fix inflation rates, how to fix bank rates, how to fix, you know, a lot of different things. And when the United States took it off the M3 index, suddenly how much money is in circulation just became, it became a black op, basically. We don't know how much money is literally out there. My prediction at that point was within 1 year we would see inflation at 20 to 25%. And we're on track for that. We've already seen inflation of about 10%, but nobody knows it yet because it's a big secret how much money is actually in circulation. So with all this money being poured into it, the stock market began to go up because capital was cheap, everything was liquid, everybody was happy because there's all this money out there. But now what's happening is the Chinese and the Europeans and everybody else are beginning to realize that now we're in this gigantic glut of dollars. So what began to occur was is that the Chinese then said, we're not going to be caught with our losing our shirts. We're going to dump $1 trillion onto the world market. The United States panicked. And this is what happened behind the scenes. We sent Henry Paulson, who I've known for about 12 years or so. We sent Ben Shalom Bernanke, the head of the Federal Reserve. We sent the head of the Commerce Department all to China to beg them not to dump $1 trillion. And let me tell you what went on behind the scenes. What happened was is that, and this comment was attributed to, we don't know who said it exactly, but it just sounds like Henry Paulson. The Chinese said, we need to dump this money because we're not going to take this kind of loss on the dollar. And we said, tell you what, how about we attack Iran, which is your major source of oil, and blow up about 100 miles worth of pipeline. And the Chinese said, what? And we said, let me put it in clearer terms. How'd you like to go without oil for about a month? How'd you like that? Because China is building a city the size of Philadelphia about every 6 months or so. Now, the Chinese interpreter, supposedly this is very dramatic, actually said this to the premier of China. And then, and what precipitated this, there is a huge note that is actually floating around out there by a U.S. ambassador named Leo Wanta. And some of you should probably look this up on the net. And what triggered the Chinese collapse and the attacks on the dollar is there's a $4.5 note being held by a former U.S. ambassador, and this note has been paid by the Treasury Department to Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs is the company that used to be run by Hank Paulson. Hank Paulson is now the U.S. Secretary of the Treasury. Now, the Treasury of the United States of America is, forgive my French, the personal bitch of Goldman Sachs, if you will. And what they have managed to do is that Goldman Sachs, with this $4.5 trillion note, has now borrowed 9 times against that note, and have now that note from bank to bank to bank to bank to bank, doing what they call a parcel post Ponzi scheme, and all these banks are getting rich off this note. In brief, and let me just give you the brief part of this, because I think this is fascinating international intrigue stuff. Am I boring you yet? Okay, it's international intrigue stuff. What Ronald Reagan wanted to do, Ronald Reagan, when he got into office, wanted to destroy the Soviet Empire. His goal to destroy the Soviet Empire was, number one, he sent a guy named Charlie Wilson. And there's a movie being made about this, by the way, with Tom Hanks playing Charlie Wilson. It's a book you can buy. It's called Charlie Wilson's War. Charlie Wilson was a U.S. congressman who went to Afghanistan. And what he did is he trained the Afghans, the Mujahideen, and set up Al-Qaeda with our buddy at that time, Osama bin Laden, gave them Stinger missiles and rockets and what have you, and allowed them to basically fight the Russian army to a standstill. So Charlie Wilson allowed the Afghans to wage this war against Russia. That was one. Phase two was he gave an ambassador named Leo Wanta, who was the U.S. ambassador to Austria, a $4.5 trillion super fund, and said to Wanta, what I want you to do is destroy the Russian economy. And what Wanta did is he was engaged in counterfeiting operations, where he counterfeited the ruble. He started dealing in junk bonds. And within a few years, what he did is he took Russia's credit rating, which was AA, to like 4D on the national market scale, by their currency, by dealing in junk bonds. And on the day when the European banks would no longer carry the loans of the Soviet Union, they walked away from the Berlin Wall, winning the war, so to speak, if you will. The rest of what this fund was supposed to be for was Ronald Reagan wanted Wanta to go back in to the Soviet Union with the help of a gentleman at that time named Michael Golinsky, a former U.S. double agent. He was a man working inside the Soviet Union. And the story of Michael Galinsky in and of itself is fascinating because Galinsky claims, here's a theory for you. Galinsky claims that he was actually Peter Romanov, the surviving czar of Russia. And that he and his family, the Romanovs, ready for this? That the Romanovs, in fact, escaped, were not murdered by the communists, but in fact were rescued by Queen Victoria and SD1 and the British Secret Service. And that they actually lived out their lives in France, and that Galinsky went back into Russia, became the number two man in the KGB, the number one man in the NKVD, stole a Russian lector, and then defected in the early 1970s. Where he brought down the British government, which was riddled with Soviet spies, and also identified people as double agents like a guy by the name of Henry Kissinger. This was Michael Galinsky. And I actually had a chance to meet this gentleman in New York, where he had fingerprints, footprints, he had hemophilia as a child, he had all the proof. And I said, how come you're not being recognized for who you are? He says, because the Chase Manhattan Bank is based on the Romanov family fortune, which was stolen from us, and I would be the richest man in the world. So very interesting story. There's all this stuff going on. The wanton note was supposed to be paid by the U.S. government. The Chinese then said, we will pay the wanton note. They then put in a request to Henry Paulson and said, are you going to pay this note? Because if you are not, we're going to honor the note. Henry Paulson said to the premier of China, he said, quote, I'm the boss, I make the decision, and his exact words were to the premier of China, I will pay this when I am goddamn good and ready, unquote. And the Chinese went, oh, okay. They lost faith. They started shorting the dollar on Thanksgiving, which then led to Paulson and Bernanke and the Commerce Secretary going to China, making the threat, we will blow up this pipeline. The Chinese minister said to his interpreter, and the interpreter then said, we do not think, when we said, how'd you like to go without oil for a month? They said, we do not think that the United States would do anything that insane. And Henry Paulson looked the guy in the eye and said, have you met the guy I work for? And the Chinese went, okay, fine, let's make a deal. And they short the currency. So this is why we now have two combat carrier groups sitting in the Persian Gulf. We have two nuclear submarines there pointing 64 nuclear missiles at the Iranians, because the bottom line of this whole war that you're about to see, we'll talk about that also, the whole war about that you're about to see, and I hope it doesn't happen, and I'll tell you why we stopped the last time as well, is also if we blow up the Iranians, specifically these pipelines, their nuclear facilities, which are a complete joke, we're after these pipelines, and cut the oil off, then that means we managed to slow China's economic development. So this is how this whole thing is now playing into it. Yes, ma'am.
But doesn't that also mean that China's going to dump the trash in the U.S.?
It's quite possible. It's quite possible. See, that's why they're saying we don't think you'd do something that crazy, because that's be what the Chinese would do. If that happens, the United States would then either go to the Amero, which is what's being talked about. Anybody seen the Amero yet? The Amero is a brand new currency. Look it up on the internet. A-M-E-R-O. The Amero is a coin. The inside, silver on the outside, that's now being proposed as the single currency from pole to pole for Canada, the United States, and all of South America. And that this will be the uniting currency for all of this. So how did this all work into what it is we're talking about? Well, let's talk about this. Let's talk about what's going to go on with the war with the war with Iran. I'll tell you what's being planned at the moment. This is kind of a fun thing. This is my latest book. This is Black Seraph. Book's great. You guys should totally get it. Someone that I co-wrote the book with is Dr. Wayne Haley. Wayne E. Haley is one of the baddest dudes alive. When I met Dr. Haley many, many years ago, he was one of the top foremost experts in counterterrorism. This is the guy who performed the tracheotomy on al-Zarqawi. This is the guy that when they dragged al-Zarqawi out of the rubble and the U.S. Marines started stomping on his chest and the guy started coughing up blood and the commander said, oh my God, we have to question this guy. He's got to live. Dr. Haley was the one who there and perform the trach. That's why when you saw the pictures, the death pictures of al-Zarqawi, he was sort of tilted like this because they had a trach scar on the right-hand side of his neck to try to allow him to live so that we could question him. Dr. Haley is a former presidential advisor. He's one of the foremost experts on counterterrorism. He teaches at the Undersea War College in Washington State. And he and I have written, actually this is book one, Black Seraph is a, if you guys like Da Vinci Code or any of Dan Brown's stuff, this is like Dan Brown meets Patterson, and this is in essence a true story, and we could not tell this story until the Pope died in April of 2005, because the story is all about the inner workings of the Vatican, the Nazi rat line that moved back and forth, the money that was moving back and forth between the Nazis and the Vatican, and it has to do with a genetic weapon as well, a DNA-specific gene bomb that can actually be exploded in a city and only kill a certain race of people. In other words, you can actually create a bomb that can only kill people with blue eyes, literally. And this is what these people have been working on. It's one of the reasons why five biogenetic scientists actually disappeared in England. One of them was named David Kelly, disappeared in England a couple of years ago, because these guys were actually working on these new designer genetic weapons. So this is what the book's all about. Dr. Haley had some very interesting things to say. Black Seraph, it's on sale in the back there.
What?
Black Seraph.
It's how, what do you spell that?
Seraph, S-E-R-A-P-H, Seraph, like the angel, the Seraph. Dr. Haley had some interesting things to say. He called me, he was talking to some people that were talking to the people writing George Bush's State of the Union address, and this is some inside Beltway stuff that's kind of fun. First off, he said that the speech, the State of the Union address, was actually written about, that it was written about 2 months ago. That the speech was actually outsourced to the State Department, where the speech writers for Condoleezza Rice had actually written the speech, that Bush had been given the speech 3 weeks in advance along with drama coaches and teachers to help him read the speech over and over again to get him over the big words. And I'm not just mocking the guy to mock him. I'm just telling you that the whole point of having these drama teachers work with him was so that he didn't sound arrogant when he delivered the speech. Because he has a way of, you know, he's got that way about him. And, you know, and I'm convinced that George Bush is sitting around watching the TV going, you know, what's this about? What's this about $12 billion disappearing in Iraq? What's this about that we're going to attack the Iranians? Well, somebody kill Anna Nicole Smith right now. Right now. Somebody make sure it's a midget with a pony. Because I like a pony. I'm sure he's behind all these things in the news because we're watching the news and it's Anna Nicole Smith and a car crash and or something else. And I'm like, there's nothing on about the war, about the massing of troops, about... So you're watching the news and it's not the news. It's like Anna Nicole fell down and hit her head and I don't know what killed her, but if anybody that ever watched a reality show, I'm stunned she lived as long as she did, aren't you? You know, hump the bear, sugar pie. You know, I was like, And, you know, if anything, I want to get Sugar Pie's money because Sugar Pie's getting all that dough. You know, there she had that dog. So I watch too much television. Anyway, so here's what he's telling me about the speech. This is a man who's a presidential advisor who's walked out of the White House shaking his head going, oh, my God, this guy really has an 89 IQ. He's going, the lights are on, but there's nobody home talking to this guy. And the rest of what he said was very funny. He said, this was before the speech came out, he said, you think this guy's told some lies before? He says, you watch the State of the Union address. And of course, I have a comment, and he thinks it's very funny, and it's actually made its way up the ladder. My comment is, blaming George Bush for the state the country is in is kind of like blaming Ronald McDonald because you don't like the hamburgers, right? He's just a clown that sort of stands out in front of the store. Well, I now think that George Bush is the Burger King. You know why? Because the White House has told more Whoppers. So he said, watch the State of the Union address because this is, he says, my God, you think this guy's told some lies before? You just wait. He says, we were cracking up just reading the speech because it's, I mean, here's George Bush who's dripping in oil, says we're going to use 20% oil. Then he says we're going to balance the budget in, you know, this year. Then he says we're going to pay the national debt in 5 years. Then he says, oh, and everybody's going to get cake and ice cream and candy. We're not going to raise taxes, blah, 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 blah. And it just went on and on and on. So here's what's going on behind right now. What's happening behind the scenes is that George Bush wanted the war with the Iranians. Actually, it's more Dick Cheney. Dick Cheney has been working nonstop for about the past 6 months with doing nothing but trying to get this war with the Iranians down. The word on the street is that if Cheney does not succeed in getting the war by this summer, that they will feed Cheney to the dogs and you will see Cheney's resignation under a cloud, if you will, in the Scooter Libby Valerie plane case, that you will see Cheney's resignation by the end of this year. Said from the beginning that I have never seen Dick Cheney actually finishing his term of office, and so my prediction from the get-go has been that you will not see Dick Cheney as vice president for much longer. The question becomes, you know, it's like every time I see Dick Cheney, first off, he's got a his assistant is named Scooter, and to me, Dick Cheney looks like the Penguin. Anybody like, rah, Batman, rah, rah, I've got you now. I'm gonna feed Robin to a giant clam, rah. And it's like the fact that he has staff named Scooter. I always picture a guy in a little bowler hat with a striped shirt with his name on the front. You know, what do you want us to do now, Mr. Penguin? He's like, you know, well, make sure Batman's good and tied up, then we'll go have cocktails and make sure he escapes. And so, I mean, no, okay, come on. How badass do you have to be? Tell me, how badass do you have to be when you shoot your friend in the face? And you know why he did it? Because the guy made a joke about Cheney's wife, and Cheney looked at him, and he was walking next to him, and Cheney did this sort of, he has this sort of apoplectic thing when he gets angry, squeezed the trigger on the gun when the guy made some joke about Lynn, and that's why he shot him in the face, because he's like right next to him. How badass do you have to be when you shoot somebody in the face and the guy comes out of the hospital and apologizes to you for letting you shoot him in the face? Because the guy came like to say, I'm really sorry to the vice president. I'm like, that's power. I mean, as far as I'm concerned, that's power. So Cheney is sitting in the East Wing putting this whole thing together right now. He's been doing nothing but pounding senators and congressmen to get this war off the ground. And if he does not succeed in some kind of attack on Iran, then he's done. Bush had called for this war in March of last year. And let me tell you, and I wrote an entire article on this called March Madness. And what happened was, is that Bush was moving ahead. The Joint Chiefs of Staff came into Bush's office. And they said, we have intelligence that says that Vladimir Putin has actually given nuclear weapons to the Ukrainians. And the Ukrainians have now given nuclear tips to the Iranians. The Iranians now have a Chinese missile known as the Sunburn missile. And the Sunburn missile travels at supersonic speeds. Now, here's the challenge. The challenge is the Persian Gulf is about 200 miles wide. Straits of Hormuz is approximately 40 miles wide. Now, about 80% of the world's oil goes through this particular strait. Also in the Persian Gulf, because it used to be Persia, Iran has about 1,000 miles of coastline, which abuts this lake, this puddle, which isn't even half as big as one of the Great Lakes, through which most of the world's oil actually moves in this area. So, first off, attacking the Iranians meant at that time that there could conceivably be a nuclear response by the Iranians. Sunburn nuclear tip missiles, that they had four of them, that they could use them against us, and we had no defense for these particular missiles, and that our fleet was sitting ducks in the Persian Gulf because it's an open sea navy, and that they could pick us off like fish in a barrel. And they said, if you do this and attack the Iranians, and if they counterattack the way we think they're going to counterattack, it means the end of the illusion of U.S. military superiority in the entire area. And Bush's exact words were, I don't care. Bring it on, is what he said. The Joint Chiefs of Staff sat back, and for the first time in history, the Joint Chiefs of Staff got together and said, we do not have to follow the orders of somebody that we consider to be clinically insane. This is not a joke. I mean, it's not a joke. This is what these guys said. And the Joint Chiefs of Staff, for the first time ever, defied a presidential order, an executive order from the President of the United States, and said the way this is structured is we do not have to commit suicide or commit our troops to suicide, and they stopped our operation. We were at DEFCON 5. We were ready to go. We had planes in the air, and the Joint Chiefs stopped it. After this, they said Bush was just, they said he ran around the White House like a monkey. That literally, he was smashing stuff. He was throwing chairs. He was so angry that this happened. What has happened in that last year? And you have seen this. And what happened was this happened in March, late March. By April, you had what was known as the General's Revolt. Remember, you guys read all this in the paper, that the people in the Joint Chiefs got on the phone to their all retired, saying, you got to stop this guy. This guy doesn't know what he's doing. If we get in this war, this is Armageddon. We're not going to push the button on Armageddon. And so then you had these retired generals began to speak out against the policies, began to do things, began to change things. And you know what's happened in that time to this? Not only were there no changes whatsoever made in the Pentagon, but Bush fired every single general that disagreed with him and replaced them with a group of these yes men bobbleheads actually in the Pentagon. Then he rerouted the structure around the Pentagon so that everything feeds directly into the White House and completely skips the Pentagon altogether, and everything now goes directly through Dick Cheney's office. That's what's happened, and that's what's different this year than last year. By the way, the Iranians still quite possibly have those nuclear tip missiles. They've still got that. They can still blow up a bunch of our stuff. Meanwhile, if what happens happens, and I talked about this on the panel yesterday, right now there's a base in Romania and Bulgaria. Everything will be ready to go attack on the Iranians by the 7th of April. I'm saying ready to go, which means at some point after the 7th, we will have boots on the ground, ships in place, two combat carrier groups, which means two nuclear submarines pointing all these nuclear weapons, and because we're going after nuclear facilities that are rather deep underground, this means the use of what they call Excalibur tactical nuclear weapons. And what these do, an Excalibur nuke actually goes straight up, comes in at an angle, and has a very, very, it's actually called, and it's 12 times harder than diamonds. And what this thing does is that it hits the ground and it spins and it drills underground and then delivers a shaped nuclear charge, 50 to 100 feet or so underground, to be able to blow up these things inside these mountains. And if we use tactical nuclear weapons against the Iranians, then the challenge will be that there is no reason in the world why Vladimir Putin cannot then turn around and say, well, why can't I use them on the Chechens? Or why the Indians can't, why can't we use them on the Pakistanis? Or why the Chinese can't turn around and say, why can't we use them on Taiwan? So there's an entire Pandora's box that opens if this action is taken in the next couple of months. Now, the really scary thing was, is that yes, we've had a changeover in the Congress, and yes, the Democrats have come to ascendancy, but when George Bush is on 60 Minutes and goes, doesn't matter, I'm the decider, I'm the commander in chief, Congress can't stop me, they can't do anything. Did you guys see the interview? He said, do you think the Congress could stop you in military action? He says, no. Chief, I decide what's what. I'm the decider. Constitution is just a goddamn piece of paper, unquote, which is what he said to the congressional leaders. So meanwhile, let me give you the rest of the scenario here. Charles Rangel has recently introduced the draft bill into the Congress. It's House Resolution, I think, 499, I think. Don't quote me on that. But this is the new draft bill. Let me scare you a little bit. You guys know what the new draft bill says? The new draft bill now ups the draft age to 42. Oh my God. Ups the draft age from 42. Longer just males, it is males and or females between the ages of 18 and 42. And there is also a division, a clause in the bill, which is a civilian draft bill. You know what that means? That means the government can come in, if the government needs accountants, they can actually come into H&R Block and draft H&R Block and force them to serve 2 years government service. That's what a civilian draft bill means. That means that the government at any time is now rescinding every single clause of what they call involuntary servitude actually in the Constitution. Now it's not just for the military, now it's for civilian service as well. So now we're talking an Israeli-type system of 2 years mandatory, from 18 to 20, mandatory military service, or if you don't want to be in the military, civilian service like the AmeriCorps, which is one of the reasons why Bush, when he first got in, set up the AmeriCorps. Remember when he was standing up there? He announced Homeland Security, which, by the way, in Germany was called the Gestapo, and then he set up what he called his AmeriCorps, which a bunch of guys in brown shirts, right? Which was also the name, you know, the Germanstaat, which was the corps that was specifically set up by the Gestapo, a bunch of guys in brown shirts, and the AmeriCorps has the same type of thing. So this is what they now, not only that do they have planned the draft, but now we have the American Foreign Legion. You're going to be hearing about this in the next couple of months. The American Foreign Legion is now setting up offices in every single one of these foreign countries, which means they will now draft foreigners into the U.S. military. And you can actually walk in Mexico City if you want. You can join the U.S. military, you can serve for 2 years, and after you'll be a citizen of the United States. That's what's next. Now, the next thing is that the Pentagon, I don't know what Bush is talking about as far as this surge where he's talking about 21,000 troops. The Pentagon, on their website, has already put in for 65,000 troops. So this 20,000 troop thing is complete nonsense. Meanwhile, there's a company called Blackwater Security. Blackwater Security, which is out of South Carolina. Blackwater Security were the guys that, they're mercenaries, basically. They're the private security firm that was actually set in to control, put under martial law, the city of New Orleans. You guys want to know who murdered everybody's pets in New Orleans? Blackwater Security. You know why? Because the first thing they did is they went around and they took out all the streetlights. Then they went around and they killed everybody's dogs. You know why? Because at night, dogs give your position away. So they rounded up everybody's dogs and shot them. That's Blackwater Security. Now they're asking for 25,000 Blackwater Security troops to go into Sudan to supposedly protect the Christians in Sudan. So you're now going to see that war begin. Awesome. The real challenge, hold on, I'll answer your question in a second. Here's the real challenge. If tomorrow the United States was to simply withdraw from Iraq, Turkey would invade through the north and take over most of Kurdistan, and in the southeast, the Iraqis and the Iranians fought an 8-year war, which means that the Iranians would now move into the southeastern section of Iraq and take over approximately 20% of the world's oil reserves. So you see the pickle that we're in? We can't afford to stay, and we really can't afford to go. So that's why we're building gigantic embassies that are like 1 square mile wide along the Tigris and the Euphrates River. So we're going to be there for a long, long time. And whether or not we actually take out the Iranians, whether or not we actually use this as a bluff, as a chip in the game, whether or not it's a power play against the Chinese, I don't know. A lot of this is going to count on how the American people react to this and whether or not we get involved and whether or not we start, you know, calling our congressman, whether or not it's going to help at all. We'll see. But this is the plan that's currently in place. The real terror of this is that just in the last few months, now we no longer have something called posse comitatus. Posse comitatus was passed in the 1880s, and it meant that federal troops could not be placed inside the continental United States. That's gone. Now we don't have habeas corpus either. You will also notice that the Sean Hannitys and the Michael Savages and the conservative neocon talking heads are more and more comparing George Bush to Lincoln. Have you noticed how much they mentioned Lincoln in the same word? Because what did Lincoln do? Lincoln suspended posse comitatus. Lincoln did all these things. I'm sorry, not posse comitatus, habeas corpus. Posse comitatus was specifically designed to keep the federal government from waging another civil war specifically. That's all gone, which means now they can put U.S. federal troops in there. And which federal troops you think they're going to pick to patrol the cities? Well, probably the people they recruit from foreign countries, because they'd be more than happy to shoot Americans. Look, I'm not a panic guy either. I'm not a person that thinks a new world order is going to take over everything. You know, there's a lot of people on the left who think this is going to happen. I deal in the practicalities of why are they going to do it? Is it cost effective for them to do it? What purpose could they have? But I'm telling you, everything's laid out. I mean, you're now seeing the groundwork has been completely laid for, in essence, some kind of one world global super state here in the United States. And I've talked to people on the inside also saying, look, they tell me, we're not so sure this guy's leaving. And they say that in all deadly seriousness. And I said, what would happen if he decided to stay? What would Bush simply said, I ain't leaving. They said he could declare, I mean, we've discussed this with a group of about 5 people on the phone. They said he could declare 180-day state of emergency, and that after the 180-day state of emergency, the Congress and the Senate must then come back into session to then decide whether or not to continue with the election process or not. Now, I think that the illusion that we choose our leader is the only thing that keeps the Matrix together. Everybody see the Matrix movies? The point that the was trying to make in the films to Neo is that he's sitting there saying to Neo, there are 2 doors. One door leads to Zion, the other door leads back into the Matrix and your demise. What the architect was trying to tell him was the Oracle came in and gave the people in the Matrix the illusion of choice, and it was the illusion of choice that allowed the Matrix to be melded together, kept the people from revolting, and therefore kept them from losing entire crops in the Matrix. And what he was trying to say, which most people is he said you can go back into the Matrix and save Trinity, where you will face your death, or you can go back to Zion, where you'll pick 16 women, 7 men specifically, and then the machines would destroy Zion, and Neo would then be the messianic figure, the power figure, if you will, to start Zion over, because the bottom line is that they could not continue to maintain the Matrix without war, without conflict, because you can't maintain a democracy the way a democracy is set up without that constant war or conflict, without an enemy to constantly be pounding against. That was the point of the Matrix movies that everybody misses, because this guy goes on for, you know, 20 minutes in the movie explaining, the guy in the white suit, the architect, explains to him Neo is to start the Matrix over so they can have a better crop of slaves, because it's a constant war. It's always the war against drugs, the war against poverty, the war against... Richard Nixon said something very interesting. He said that in the absence of an external enemy, States of America would simply collapse in upon itself. So without us creating an enemy, whether or not it's the Muslims or the Russians or the Chinese or whatever, the U.S. just simply implodes. I'm going to talk about some prophecy stuff now. Let me get some questions. Yes, Gigi, you had a question?
I have one question. What if your Secure Party creditor becomes
wrapped? I'm sorry?
What if you are a Secure Party creditor
becomes a new wrapped? Okay. A couple of things. Her question was, what if you're a Secure Party creditor? In terms of this draft, that gives me a whole other lecture of explaining what a secured party creditor is. What I can say is that, yes, if you've opted out and you own yourself, here's the trick. Listen closely. Don't look at your notes. Look at me. Here's the trick. Is slavery in the United States legal?
Yeah.
Is it? 14th Amendment was, you know, Emancipation Proclamation, all that other stuff. Freed the slaves, supposedly. Again, I will ask you, is slavery in the United States legal?
No.
Some people do? Who says no?
Don't know.
Raise your hands. Who says yes? Okay, you're both kind of right. Slavery is illegal in the United States constitutionally. The only way that you, as citizens of the United States, can be enslaved is by contract. Is by contract. Because contract supersedes the Constitution. People, where's the lady that works for the IRS? There's an IRS lady in here. She doesn't want to stand up because Walter rocks at her or something, I guess. Anyway, there's a lady who works for the IRS. And one of the things I pointed out is there's all these people that claim, all right, there's a $50,000 reward for anybody that says, can you show me the law that says that I have to pay taxes? It doesn't matter. Bottom line is you contracted into it. You signed a piece of paper that said you volunteered. And I try to point out to people, if I go in and I join the Marine Corps and I sign a paper that says I joined the Marine Corps and I don't show up, what do? Right. If I go into the IRS and I sign a paper that says I volunteer to pay taxes and then I don't pay them, what do? They go after me. Therefore, you are contractually enslaved because a contract supersedes the Constitution. If I work for Oprah and I sign a clause, I don't know why Oprah. If I work for Oprah and I sign a clause that says I'm not supposed to say anything about Oprah, right? Is that a violation of my First Amendment right to freedom of speech?
No.
Yes or no?
No.
Kind of. But
voluntary
contract, exactly. Which means if I go out and say, well, I think Oprah's kind of bitchy, or whatever I say about Oprah, or I think she's great, or whatever, she can sue me because I signed a voluntary contract, right? Same thing. So what Gigi's asking for is that as a secured party creditor, you in fact opted out. You've informed the state that you are no longer their property. And by informing the state that you are in fact a sovereign citizen of those states, that you own your straw man legis, as it's called, because how the government controls you is your name in all capital letters, that you own and control your straw man legis, they have no power over the straw man legis. Here's one other thing. I was gonna talk about this. You guys wanna talk about freedom? Here's something else, kind of fun. We got in the United States of America, and we saw habeas corpus revoked, and posse comitatus, and the draft, and everything coming. We got so sick of the United States that we started our own country. I'm not kidding. Not kidding. Here's how we started our own country. This is no lie. What happened was this country was actually formed in 1991. There was some shenanigans that kind of happened with the country in the 90s, and myself and President Richard McDonald, and Richard McDonald is one of the most famous states' rights sovereign citizen guys around, basically took over the infrastructure of this company, of this country, I'm sorry, and we now are, I'm the ambassador at large, and he's the president for what is now the reformed Dominion of Melchizedek. So now I'll tell you this. Now you can look up, we're in the process, we took the website down, we kicked everybody else that had anything to do with this country completely out. Anything you hear about Melchizedek in the past, there were people that were selling passports or banking license or whatever, total nonsense. We've cleaned the entire thing up. Most of those people had nothing to do with the Dominion as it is. The Dominion of Melchizedek owns two islands in the Marshall Island chain. One of them is called the Tiangi Atoll, which we have on a 99-year sovereign lease, and I just think this guy's name is kind of funny, from King Iron Lap Lap, actually is his name. Sounds like a guy who hangs out a lot of strip bars, I would say. But King Iron Lap Lap, we also have claimed 30% of Antarctica, and we're in the process of getting an island in Belize and another island directly off of Italy. So what this is an ambassadorial passport by which you can use this to travel anywhere inside the United States, and this actually says ambassador at large. I'll let you guys take a look at it later on. And you can travel anywhere inside the United States. Specifically, you can't use this passport to get in or out of the U.S. because we have not yet been recognized by the State Department. However, we are 85% through our security checks with Russia. We are in the process of purchasing an embassy in Moscow. We have an embassy in the Ukraine. Our public affairs minister, actually our foreign affairs minister is the former minister of Tajikistan. So all of this stuff is all coming together. And let me tell you, here's what's cool. I used this at LAX. This rocks, man. I used this, you know, that big long line that you have to wait through. I walked up to the very front to the TSA guy. Guy stopped me, said, hang on, buddy, where are you going? I flashed him. I said, this is my ambassadorial passport. I was wearing my suit and tie. Guy lifted up the rope, said, right this way, sir. Brought me through. They were putting my bag on the thing. And I said, I'm sorry, but under the Viennese Diplomatic Relations Council, the VDRC, that's illegal. That's a diplomatic bag. It can't be searched. He goes, oh. Picked it up off the thing, walked it around, walked the whole thing around, shook my hand afterwards and said, thank you, I've never seen an ambassadorial passport before. There you go. So now here's the key. The key to this is that you become a citizen of the Dominion of Melchizedek. Now here's the advantage. By becoming a citizen, what you get, I don't know, I feel like I'm on the Home Shopping Network here. But wait, there's more. This is issued by the United Nations, and seeing this, but this is an international driving permit. How'd you like to drive around Los Angeles without being afraid of getting a ticket? So there's your international, there's your United Nations international driving permit. Now, you can go to the auto club, you can get an international driving permit, but it's only good for outside the United States. In order to get an IDP, anywhere you go, it'll cost anywhere between $750 and about $2,000, and they usually issue them out of Honduras or Nicaragua, but then you gotta like pretend you're from Honduras or Nicaragua when the cops, it works like in Wisconsin where they don't speak Spanish because the cops all speak Spanish here, right? You know, but this one actually comes from the Dominion of Melchizedek. So here we go, here's your international driving permit, which means you can dump your driver's license. That's the cool part. And what the next thing that's going to happen, hold on one second, the next thing that's going to happen is in 2008, they're going to use the driver's license as the national ID, which means that it's going to be your social security number, your insurance, your health care, your taxes, your, and now, by the way, starting in 2008, you know you can't, you have to have your passport to go to Canada. Do you know that? Have to have your passport. The new passports that they're actually issuing now have a biometric chip in the passports as well. Do not fry the biometric chip. The only way you can get rid of that chip, don't put it in the microwave, don't tear it out. If they get you through there and they see the page has been torn out with the chip on it, they can technically, never happened, it's like tearing the tag off the pillow that tells you not to, but technically that's a federal offense. Here's what you do. You take your new passport that has the chip, get a nice big hammer, hit it once with a hammer, smash, and that actually smashes the biometric chip. With the rest of these comes, hold on, you get two cards. You get another card here. This is your diplomatic identification card, which actually has the stamp of Melchizedek on it. But wait, there's more. This is your domestic driving ID, which is what you hand the cops. Or whatever. Now, you register your car inside the US to a company or an LLC, which is what you should do anyway, and then use all this stuff to drive. Right now, immigration fees to becoming a citizen of Melchizedek, and I don't have anything to do with this. This is all President McDonald and his administration, are $2,500 to get all this. If you want an ambassador passport, and there's the good news and the bad news. The bad news is that the ambassador passport, since it has not yet been recognized by the State Department, means you can't use this to move in and out of the United States. However, it is good outside the US. Anybody that travels in the Middle East, like I have, you better have one of these. Because if you get stopped or whatever happens, and you flash an American passport, you don't know what can happen to you. So it's always good to have a neutral country. And the motto of Melchizedek is monotheism, unity, and peace. And that's our goal, is monotheism, to unify humanity and to bring peace anywhere we go. Let me tell you a little bit about Melchizedek. The priests of Melchizedek were actually the last family of the priesthood of Zadok. And in the last days of Israel, they were the only ones that were loyal to the ever-living God while Israel was in an apostate state. The priests of Zadok worshipped the archangel Michael, or Michael, as their intercessor, the son of God, literally to God, which is how we get the word Michael, Zadok, Melchizedek, Melchizedek. That's actually where it comes from the priests of, and actually it was believed that Jesus Christ himself was a member of the ancient order of Melchizedek. That's where it all comes from. So Melchizedek actually means those who are faithful and loyal to the true ever-living God in the apostate last days, which I think is kind of cool considering what's going on with the rest of the world. An ambassador passport, which allows you to travel under the Viennese Diplomatic Convention, is $10,000 for all this stuff. But once we get our country code, these will be like $100,000. Or if you talk to President McDonald and you can provide some kind of benefit to the Dom, like a consulate or contacts in a foreign nation or whatever, there's the good chance that just being a good person or doing good deeds, we'll get you an ambassadorial, a goodwill ambassadorial passport. Yes, lovely lady.
If you had teenage children and you wanted to prevent them from the draft, would Costa Rican citizenship be a safe place? Or it's just very concerning.
Sure. I think. You can have dual, here's how dual citizenship works. About 10 or 15 years ago, the Supreme Court ruled that if your parents or grandparents were from a foreign nation, you could apply for dual citizenship, dual passports. Now, there was a conflict 6 years ago that came up in front of the Supreme Court because the American Jewish community said that Israel was their Jewish, was their spiritual homeland, so they had a religious obligation to become citizens of Israel and the United States, even though they didn't hail from there. So 6 years ago, the Supreme Court said, okay, well, if we're going to do it for the Jews, then we have to do it for everybody. Therefore, with Melchizedek, you simply say, well, it's my spiritual homeland, and that allows you dual passports or dual citizenship. So there's about two or three different Supreme Court rulings now that allow you dual citizenship. And until we get our country code from the United Nations, which is not that far away, We're getting recognized by Russia. We're getting recognized by the Chinese. We've already been recognized by the Ukraine, Nigeria, Cameroon, Central African Republics, Brussels, Basel Fayil, and we're working on Belize, El Salvador, Costa Rica, all those places as to recognize the nation state. And President McDonald just got a medal from Vladimir Putin, which he sends to the presidents of all the countries. So, kids, this is a real deal. I know it's just kind of starting just now, but it's a real thing. And we got, and the only way that we found, and how sad is this, the only way that we found to defend our rights as human beings was to not be Americans anymore. I mean, I know that's just sick, I know, and it's just wrong and it's sad. But that's the bottom line. This passport allows me more, allows me my Fourth Amendment rights against search and seizure and whatever else. And by the way, once you become an ambassador, that means your home can become a consulate, which means no taxes, no codes, cops can't even come to your house. There's all kinds of advantages to it. And if your kids, if you become the ambassador, like for example, if you're the ambassador, your husband automatically gets one free and your children the children of the ambassador. So when you pay the $10,000 for the ambassadorship, it's good for your whole family. So everybody actually gets the travel documents. Actually, he had his hands up first. Yes, sir. Yes.
You had said a while ago that you didn't think Bush would finish his term. And
I still think that. I'll talk about that later.
The Secret Service came in to visit you in your Incredible Hulk shorts.
That's a funny story, actually.
Apparently now you're saying Cheney falls off the bus first.
Okay. No, it's, well, I'll talk about that. Let me get to that. Yes.
No, sure. Why don't you speak about Kizadakian?
We just Melchizedek. You want to talk more about the Melchizedek stuff?
Do they have a language?
No. Well, actually, it's because it's Tiangi, but it's English. The language. It's in Western Polynesia. You can look it up on Google. It's hard to find.
It's in the Bible.
It's in the Bible too, under Order of Melchizedek. Yes, ma'am.
But you still have all the benefits of being a U.S. citizen.
Of course, you still have your U.S. passport. Yes.
And the other tag on is back to Condoleezza Rice, back to Cheney. Why is she still there? Because she's good. She's intelligent. Why is she?
Why is Condoleezza still there?
Yeah.
She does whatever they say.
Why
whatever. I'm not. I don't know. I don't know what. I don't know their thinking on this. Yes, you have your hand up first.
Expire? Is there an expiration date?
It's 15 years. Yes, ma'am.
Last year, I talked to the founder of a rescue organization for animals.
Okay.
And they were the first to get into New Orleans. And I asked her, "Did you see a lot of shot dogs?" And she said, "Hundreds."
Yeah.
And she didn't understand.
It was the security people. They also there's the Blackwater security guys. It was the martial law people that went in there. That's right. That's right. They wouldn't tell you anything about it because they shot the dogs, because they would give away the positions at night, because the guys were using infrared to basically scan the streets. Question in the back. Yes, sir.
Yeah. When do they start putting the biochip in the passport?
They start next year. I think if you apply for one now, this year, they're in already. But as of 2008, they'll be in all passports issued after 2008. As far as I know, I don't have a new passport, but I think somebody, no, I'm sorry, they're in now.
They're
in now.
Yeah,
they're already there now. They're a little metal chip, actually. Like I said, just take a hammer and hit it once.
Will you get into trouble? Or
if you hit it once with a hammer, you can simply say, well, I don't know, I must have dropped it or something. And then you can just use an excuse. Gigi's asked a bunch of questions. The adorable lady over there has her hand up. Yes, lovely girl.
Thank you.
You're welcome. You are lovely.
So if you hit your passport, how do you get in and out of customs?
That's fine. They just, you know, they just run the name. That's just the same thing. The only thing the biochip does is tap you into tax records. I mean, there's a whole bunch of other stuff that they, I mean, number two, it's mostly empty, so you know they're going to start filling that chip up with a lot more information. Eventually, the goal is to use the immigration problem to have a national ID, and that national ID will be your driver's license, your Social Security card, and it will have that strip on the back or the biochip in it. And actually, Popular Science, 2 years ago, I did a thing in my newsletter, Popular Science did a thing on it, all about what the biochip will have, and it'll have your tax records, your health records, all your information, your criminal records. A cop can pull you over, literally, see when you went to the doctor last and for what. You know, that's... I don't know. The EU passports, I don't know.
We're going to require them to enter this country, I think.
Probably.
Maybe just delay it a year or two.
Yeah. It's quite possible that if you come in, remember, if you're a European coming in, they fingerprint you now, they photograph you. It's, you know, they treat you like a real crook when you come in here.
But that's your project.
Yes. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, where do you get the passport of Melchizedek?
Actually, just write down... L Chi, like Tai Chi, C-H-I, Zedek, Z-E-D-E-K, Melchizedek.com. The website was taken down specifically because we got rid of everybody else that had anything to do with this. So we're in the process of actually putting the website back up again with all the new information on it and the new government and the new administration. And we've also got a disclaimer that says, you know, anything that came before has nothing to do with this administration. So, you know, running everything on the clean, on the up and up, you know, on the super cool. The idea here is, again, is we're going, I'm going to be flying, I think, to the Ukraine this summer because we've got a consulate set up there, got a property in Moscow. So, I mean, this whole thing is, and we're connecting also with the Knights of Malta and the Knights of St. John the Hospitalliers, because we're in the process of shipping medical supplies to Haiti. We've got 600 beds that are shipping there. We've got medical supplies going to Haiti. The Knights of St. John want to set up a hospital on an island off of Italy. So this is tapping us into the National Red Cross, the Knights of Malta, into all of these charitable organizations as well. Our goal is to have a spiritual nation state of angels, if you will, of people who are of goodwill all across the world that can band underneath this the single banner of monotheism, unity, and peace. So that's the goal here. The short term good thing is that it allows you to escape from a lot of government oppression at the same time. Melissa has something to say. Yes, Mrs. Morton. And we pay all legal taxes. I'm required to say that. Pay all legal taxes. Yes, handsome man in the back there. Yeah, boss. Yeah. Very good. The man has a good point that I've talked about this quite a great deal, that currently they started in the military. A lot of people are worried about the mark of the beast, if you will. You've all got that mark in your cell phones, by the way, because your cell phones identify you, they track you, they can find you in 9 seconds, they can turn your phone on, your conversations in your house, under echelon, they can do anything they want with your cell phones. The question was, is that these chips started with U.S. military special forces, and they were called MARC, M-A-R-C-C, which is Multiple Automated Readout Computer Chip, and they went into a supercomputer known as the Battle Engagement Arena Simulation and Tracking Computer, also known as the Beast, or the Mark of the Beast, quite literally. And what these chips were, actually, for anybody that saw Mission Impossible 3, they've now popularized them. And they put them behind the ear, and they're tracking and communication chips, and they're right behind the carotid artery, and they have a small amount of acid actually in them, so you can actually hit them remote controlledly. They dig into the carotid artery, you know, flood your brain with blood, and pop goes your spy, if you will. So if you're interjecting an agent or a black op or whatever, and you want deniability, you can just hit these guys and self-destruct them by remote control. On the positive side, if you get wounded, they can ship in a MASH helicopter, they can ship you out, they put a laser, a grocery reader up to your head, they hit the tag on it, and all your medical history comes up on the board, so that comes up on the computer board, so that a MASH doctor knows if you're allergic to penicillin or if you've got a broken knee or any other problems or whatever. But these chips now are now being developed for the passports, for the driver's licenses. You've got GPS chips in your cell phone. I mean, if they want to get you, they're going to get you, is the bottom line. The idea is whether or not you know enough about your rights, you know, as a citizen, or whether or not you're a Melchizedekian and, you know, have a whole different set of rights. You know, to be able to defend yourself. I got a lot more to go here, so yes, Paul.
John, the tracking capability of the prepaid cell phones like they sell at Walmart?
Tracking capability of prepaid cell phones, far less than the cell phones that actually have the GPS chip that actually track into a home address and a home phone and all that. But for example, here's another hint for you. The cell phone I have, and this is kind of a cool thing, this cell phone was one of the original black Motorolas. This is from Europe. The European cell phones don't have the chip in them. This from a European company, and it doesn't have a chip that actually tracks in the U.S. So it's just something kind of fun. Yes, question, sir.
You talked about kids. If you're an ambassador, your kids automatically become.
Correct. They become children of the ambassador, and your wife automatically becomes an ambassador too, or wives, plural, whatever you want.
Kids have to be under 18 or something like that, or is it
no?
Just your children.
Child, son of ambassador, daughter of ambassador. Helps, you know, if you want to flash the cops some ID. The other point to this is too is that we are now working on. They used to issue them. With an ambassadorial appointment, you can take it into DMV, and we're working on, they used to do this, and about 6 months ago they revoked it, now we're talking to the governor's office about getting it back, but you can actually get honorary consulate plates on your car, issued by the state of California. It's cool, I'm telling you, which means that your car is a rolling piece of a foreign country, which means you can't even be stopped, you can't be towed, you can't be stopped, you can't be searched. If your home is a consulate, which is another cool thing, means the only thing they can do is send the firemen to your house if you're on fire, but means your property becomes inviolate. It means the cops can't even set foot on your property. It's cool. It's, you know, it's neat. But at the same time, we're looking for people that are not going to abuse that privilege. And unfortunately, we had a guy who got consulate plates on his car in Nevada, and he went down the strip at 150 miles an hour, and they threw him in the pokey and revoked his plates. So, yes, sir.
Is there an example of anyone else that started
Yeah, sure. I mean, there's Tonga. There's Sealand, which Bates, which I actually studied Sealand because I wanted to write a movie about it because I thought it was really funny. Roy Bates actually found an oil rig in the North Sea in international waters, climbed up it, made it a certain height, and claimed it as his own country, named himself Prince Roy, actually, named himself literally king or prince of his own country. They have a flag, they have a stamp, and now they're selling Sealand for $975 million, just to give you an idea. So it is, and by the way, there's 500 people that live on the island, there's an airstrip, we have a pelican named Frank, you know, I mean, it's a whole, we got a whole thing there. So, I mean, it's on a sovereign lease, and of course the challenge is we're trying to buy the island, so the island is ours outright. So anyway, let me talk about some other things too, because I've got a lot of things to go here. Let me give you some dates and some kind of other interesting stuff as to what's going to happen financially, because this year is going to be, I'm working on my predictions issue for the newsletter, a little late like usual, but the predictions issue for the newsletter, I call this the year of living dangerously because of all the things that are going to go on this year. So hold on one second. These lights make it really hot up here. Any other questions while I'm taking a drink? Anybody?
Have you been to your country?
Not yet. I don't have a boat. I don't have a boat big enough to get there yet. No, you know what I'm terrified of? I'm terrified that the United States is going to extradite me. Survivor Melchizedek, you know? I have to actually go live in my own country. So that's one of those fun things. All right. Where are we at? Okay, we're in February right now of 2007. 2007 obviously adds up to a 9. This being a 9 year means it's going to be particularly harsh on us. Anybody that lived, how many people lived in Los Angeles through the 90s? Anybody? Did it not like totally suck to live in Los Angeles in the 90s? Everything that happened here, if you remember. Short memories, I don't, living here in LA. I remember that we had the Landers earthquake, we had the Northridge earthquake, we had the Malibu fires twice, we had the Laguna floods and fires twice, we had OJ, which took up most of the 90s, we had the riots, we had probably the single worst natural catastrophe, probably the most heinous criminal act to ever be committed was UCLA beat USC 8 years in a row. That's what blew. Travesty. So the 90s were very hard. The 90s were very, very hard on Los Angeles. And unfortunately, the 90s being, what else can I say? The 90s was like the decade of crime. So the thing that's going to happen this year is you're going to see a lot of criminal acts by the government against its own citizens. You're going to see a lot of patriotic protests against the government, especially if the war with the Iranians actually gets rolling. And let me give you a couple of things that are also in the mix now. We're in this 5-year countdown now to 2012. And a lot of people talk about 2012 and why 2012 is important. And it's important because there are, again, a number of ancient monuments and structures that if you understand the time coding of these monuments, point to the next 5 years of being, on the one hand, for those that are not prepared, immensely chaotic. But on the other hand, for those people that are prepared, spiritually, emotionally, and financially, I might add, as being years of amazing wonder and a chance for our own ascension. But I literally see that what's going to happen is that there's going to be literally the separation of the wheat and the chaff, the goats and the sheep, the light and the dark, if you will. And as these two extremes begin to shift and begin to open, that the worse things get, the better things get as well. Does that make sense? Because, again, we're seeing all this darkness. The only thing that I is that for a George Bush, I can't even think of anybody. I mean, there used to be like, but for a George Bush, there's the Dalai Lama. Maybe that's the best way for me to put it. For a Hillary Clinton, there's an Amaji. There's a balance on the world. There's a balance in the planet. There's a constant. And all these people think, oh, it's going to be great when Hillary Clinton's president. Yes, because the world has been so peaceful when women have been in power. Like Indira Gandhi and Golda Meir and Margaret Thatcher. So peaceful, their regime. They didn't declare war on anybody. So the idea behind this is that this 5-year amplification period is, and let's just lay it out there, the Mayan calendar says that by the end of this year will be the beginning of Armageddon. That's it. Beginning of Armageddon, that by November, specifically November 7th of 2007, that Armageddon begins. It also states that Armageddon will begin and that Germany will be behind most of it. And The idea, and here's what I'm looking at, and this is one of the reasons why the foreign exchange markets and what I do with the stock market is so interesting. When you trade stocks and when you do foreign exchange, all I can tell you is that the global financial markets are the single greatest intelligence gathering apparatus ever conceived of by the mind of man. You know why? Because if somebody blows up a pipeline in Radaya, 10 minutes later, somebody's short in oil somewhere in the world. And all you have to do, because now with the internet, there is a web of intelligence and information, and it won't hit the papers for days, if not months, it won't hit CNN for whatever, but you can bet somebody's there, Johnny on the spot, making a buck off it. And if you're actually scanning that web of information going, wow, I wonder why the Japanese yen's doing this. That's interesting. The Japanese yen recently is just jumping off a cliff. All right, well, that means that nobody can import anything to Japan. It means the Japanese goods in the next 6 months are going to be super cheap. The Japanese yen is just completely out of the blue. The Japanese yen, by the way, is at almost a 40-year high. So you're looking at the Japanese yen going, geez, well, that means Toyotas and Hondas, everything Japanese is going to be super cheap for about the next 3 or 4 months or so. It also means that nothing can be imported into Japan. So the G7 countries, used to be the G8, but I think France quit. Like usual, we don't want you to see the Europeans. We like our own croissants. terrible Pepe Le Pew impression. So the G7 are actually meeting now to figure out what to do about the Japanese. Therefore, we're looking at something happening in Asia on the world economic markets. I'll bet you haven't even heard yet that Kim Jong-il showed up in London with about $2 billion worth of gold bullion. Anybody know that?
No.
Yeah. Well, we heard about it in the foreign exchange markets. You know why? Because it started altering the price of gold. And we thought, where the hell did Kim Jong-il get $2 billion worth of gold? And we began to realize that this was the payoff for Americans and the Chinese for him to stop blowing off nuclear bombs. And this is what I said on George Norrie's program. I said, well, he's blowing off the nuclear bombs so that he can jump up and down with his hand out to get paid so he doesn't blow off anymore. And guess what? He just got paid. So
what did that do to the price of gold?
It dropped the price of gold by about 16 bucks.
So it's a good time to buy, right?
It is now. You also saw, and let me tell you how things are shaping up. Just before Thanksgiving, just before the Chinese went crazy, just before gold started going down, just before the fluxes in the world markets and what started happening, about in late October, the beginning of November, 2% of the world's gold was transported from Jakarta to Brussels. Now, there is a huge gold cachet, this whole gold cache that's in the Philippines and Jakarta, that's being run by a very mysterious underworld figure that everybody knows as the uncle in the intelligence community. And everybody thinks, and I'll tell you what they think, it's Ferdinand Marcos. They don't think he's dead. They think that he's his death, and that he's actually running huge amounts of Japanese gold stash, if you will, out of the Philippines. This is what the intel guys think. So what's happened is 2% of the world's gold went from Jakarta into Brussels. The Europeans are making a major play right now to back the euro with gold. Now, there is no difference, my forgiveness to my European friend over there, there is no difference between the current European Economic Union and I guess what Hitler would call the Fourth Reich, because it's run by the Germans. Barrel. The thing is economically run by the Germans, it's industrially run by the Germans, the whole thing is the Germans. And this is a renewed Fourth Reich, if you will, and it's interesting that if you look at the Mayan codexes and the Mayan prophecies, they have something that's called a galactic, a planetary, and a national week. It's actually the opposite way. The national week is approximately, it's hard to explain. The national week, look at the fifth day, which is what we're entering into. The national week focuses on world chaos happening in Germany at the center between approximately 432 and about 600 AD or so, which is Attila the Hun and the rise of the Vandals and the collapse of the Roman Empire. That was that period of time. Then if you look at the next period of time, which is the fifth day again in the Mayan Codex and the Mayan calendar, it actually gives you from 1932 to approximately 1947. And says, once again, the center of the world tree, which is Germany, is going to rise to power and cause chaos throughout the world. Well, guess what? Again, what they call the final galactic underworld day, which lasts from November 7th of this year, 2007, until approximately December 10th of 2008, says global Armageddon will be triggered once again by the Germans, by something that has to do with the consolidation of Germany and the consolidation of the euro specifically. This is what the calendar says. This is what it points to. excellent book on this. It's a fantastic book. It was written by Dr. Carl Johan Kalman. It's called The Mayan Calendar and the Transformation of Consciousness. And he's come up with something revolutionary that they call the Kalman Index. And the Kalman Index actually has a time coding or a series of dates that he's broken down, not just for this time, but he's gone back through history and looked at the global history of the planet and shown how it directly relates to the Mayan calendar. And it's fascinating because it relates to exactly what's going to happen between now and approximately 2012. I'll give you some of my predictions on this. Yes, lovely lady in the back. It is Carl, it's Kalleman, C-A-L-L-E, call, E-man. Yeah, I'll put it on the table back there at the end. I'm not selling it, but it's Carl Eman. It's called The Mayan Calendar and the Transformation of Consciousness. They sell it at the Bodhi Tree. They should have it at the bookstore. It's a pretty popular book. One of the fascinating things about what he talks about, specifically, I'll just read the definition of it specifically, because I think this is very interesting. He talks about that there's a 7-day phase, and this 7-day phase talks about day one, which lasts from January 5th, 99, and there's a day and a night specifically, January 5th, 99 through December 24th of 2000 is what they call the day of sowing. And it says the IT revolution, living on light, wars of the West with Iraq and Serbia, first protests in Seattle against global materialist power. That's the day. The night is the backlash of the IT revolution, resting period following the initial day of the galactic underworld. The next day, day two, it's December 25th, 2000 to December of 2002, which is germination of the seed, continuing protests against global materialist power, terrorist attacks against the World Trade Center and Pentagon, Western war in Afghanistan. The night is deep economic recession, reestablishment of Western dominance, reaction against most expressions of the high frequency of the galactic underworld, cultural search for answers in ancient culture. This course begins in 2002. The third day, from December 02 to December 04, is sprouting. Once again, Western war in Iraq, strengthened movement against global power of materialism, establishment of new expression of spirituality, intuition-based living, dowsing, revival of Mayan calendar, remote viewing, spiritual healing. Also, the first Venus transit, June 8th of 2004, crucial for the preparation of the unifying synthesis day. Day four, moving into day four now. And the day four is from December of 2004 to approximately November of 2006, the proliferation, and that's the formulation of core unifying synthesis between East and West and between spirituality and rationality, and final, and then the dissemination of the unifying synthesis. Now we're moving into where we're at now. Now is the budding from 06 to approximately November 06 to November of 2008, breakthrough of new advanced synthesis in manifestation of galactic Christ consciousness. That means that this year, let's talk about this year, this is what's most interesting. This year, according to the Kalman Index, it says that we will have a new advanced form of the unifying synthesis and a manifestation of the galactic Christ consciousness. What's that mean? The unifying synthesis according to the Mayans, and this is what's the most, thank you, the unifying synthesis according to the Mayans, I got to talk very fast now because this lady's waving at me, so the unifying synthesis in the Mayans, and this is what I talked about earlier in the panel. Yesterday, is all is one, life has purpose, God is love. Now that seems like very, very simple, but let's break that down. All being one means specifically that there's no difference between you and the planet and the universe and the cosmos. There's no difference between you and the other people, that you are all diverse manifestations of the Spirit of God, that everything is the essence of one. Edgar Cayce talked about a new religion that's based on all is one. Everything being one and everything being unified is you as part of a drop, if you will, in the uniform ocean. Life has purpose means that no matter how screwed up your life is, that no matter who's done you dirty, who done you wrong, no matter what circumstances have brought you, no matter who you blame for your life being miserable, your life being bad, or no matter why you want to bitch or how you want to complain or what you want to moan about, it means you're exactly where you need to be at the exact moment that you need to be there for the exact reason that you need to be where you're at. You guys with me on this? And I think that's one of the most important ones. That means your life having purpose. We're not a bunch of monkeys jumping around on a dirt ball in the middle of the cosmos, that our life not only has purpose, but all life has some purpose and has some major goal. And God is love, which is the final core synthesis, means that the prima mobile, the first thought, the zygote, the sperm-hitting egg in the universe, means that the prime mobilizing force of the cosmos is love, is the greatest good for the greatest number of beings within that universal creation. And the core synthesis science is that we have to start understanding that all is one, life has purpose, God is love, and that has to become part of our DNA, part of our bone and marrow and sinew, that has to become part of our genetics. And when we understand that, clearly, that's the secret to manipulating the force, if you will, to whatever it is we want it to do. When we talk about time speeding up in the 21st century, we talk about moving into the fifth dimension. Well, it's not just a pretty song by the fifth dimension about the moon and the seventh house or whatever. It means we live in three dimensions of height, width, breadth, and time being the fourth dimension. Time is now speeding up because we now have cell phones, computers, we now have the internet, we now have all these amazing things that are now condensing time, allowing us more information. Heck, I don't think ADD is a disease. I think it's a survival mechanism for the future, I think. And of course, you know, attention deficit disorder in Los Angeles, we have what we call GADD, which is getting attention deficit disorder here. So it's, because it's the movie business and all that. LA is the only place you can die from ignorance. So, as those of you in the film business know. And so this aspect of the core synthesis now generating in us, this basically means that this year, I mean, this is what this means to me. Breakthrough of new and advanced form of unifying synthesis. What that means, new forms of consciousness. Because if we're breaking through the boundaries of time, if we're no longer living on a 24-hour day, if that 24 hours is now where we can become conscious of things that happen or Tokyo or Japan or across the United States, we have a global consciousness. 9/11 was the first major event that happened to the world. The Olympics happened to the world. We can witness events globally and have a global consciousness of this. The next thing is that it means that the Christ consciousness, the galactic Christ consciousness, begins to take physical form. And that means one of two things. One, that there's a wave of children now being born and now coming in that are going to be messiahs, if you will, that are going to be born God-knowing. And number two, it means that time synthesis, the all is one, life has purpose, God is love, is now going to be part and parcel of who and what it is you are. And what happens is that when you make that part of your heart, when you actually bring that in and take what's here and bring it here and open those wings up in your back, what I call the 12 chakra energy system, then when you come at things with love, you can communicate with animals, communicate with others, communicate telepathically, and you begin to live in a fifth dimensional world spirit, where that which you think becomes physical reality, which is magic in essence. Thinking something and it appearing directly in front of you, that's magic. That's the essence of the secret that they've, this little cheesy movie that they're, where, you ever notice in that movie that all the people that are really stupid are Australian and all the spiritual masters are all Americans? You ever notice that? It's like an Australian goes, hey, shucks, mate, I just took another dump, eh? And it's like, you know, an American comes in and says, this is why you took that dump, eh? Because you didn't practice the secret. So I mean, they put one Australian in there to go, you know, hi, here's the way you do it, mate. You need to do it like this. Yeah, there you go. Time a kangaroo down, eh, Waltz and Matilda? So, it's a terrible John Wayne impression. Anyway, so, but here's where the rubber meets the road. November 19th of 2007 is the final aspect of the budding. Deep crisis for global materialist culture. That means a crash in the markets, kids. It also means destructive reaction, which means war. And notice it says reaction, which means we take some sort of action to which there is a terrorist or war reaction against it. And the beginning of global Armageddon. And it says the European Union and Germany will be at the center of the drama. I see it happening now. I see what's going to happen is that we're going to have the Iranians start trading their oil in euros instead of dollars, which is going to collapse the US dollar, and we're going to be in a whole lot of trouble. The next day after that, from November of 2008 through 2009, is the flowering. So the advanced unifying synthesis, tense coexistence of East and West between new spirituality and the remnants of global materialistic power. That sounds pretty dire. Remnants of global materialist power. You know what that means? A massive global economic collapse. You know what that's also going to mean? That's going to mean that not only is the rubber going to meet the road, but by 2008, I am telling you, if I'm standing here a year from now, in 2008, everybody in this room and all of those in that web of people that you contact and touch and everybody that you effect and all that you know and all that you love and all that you fear and love that you hate and you know the whole Dark Side of the Moon song, that whole thing, you're going to affect this and your path is going to become really, really clear at that point. Really clear. Because 2005 was the beginning of the foundation of a new culture that's going to be based on aspects of the spiritual. Now, one of the reasons and let me just try to fold all this together, let me read you the rest of this because I think it's very interesting. The last day of the flowering is from November 09 210, resting period in preparation for attaining balance between the East and the West. Second harmonic convergence is May 27th of 2010. Write it down. May 27th of 2010. It's actually the 27th, 28th, and 29th is the next harmonic convergence. It's the last chance we're going to have to link the entire world. And for those of you that have media connections or music connections or whatever, my goal is to do something where we get, say, let's link the chakra points of the world. There's six major chakra points on the planet. The base root chakra is Lhasa, Tibet, at the Patola in Lhasa, Tibet. The second chakra, the prostodovarian chakra, is the Great Pyramid of Giza in Cairo, Egypt. The third chakra, which is the solar plexus, is Stonehenge in England. The throat, the heart chakra, the base frequency is Machu Picchu in Peru, and the high frequency is Easter Island. The throat chakra is downtown Los Angeles at the gazebo on Alvera Street. Live from New Hollywood, it's Saturday. It's Radio City. It's what's all New York. It's Hollywood is television, film, radio. That which we speak here becomes reality all around the world. And the sixth chakra is a place outside of Osaka, Japan, called Tenri City. And there's a temple called Tenrikyo where they've got a huge red granite pillar that goes directly into the third eye. The red dot, the bindu on the Japanese flag, is actually the rising sun of consciousness. It's the rising sun of consciousness. So wouldn't it be great if we could chakras together? I mean, let's get U2 performing in Lhasa, and let's get Sting performing in front of the pyramids, and let's get Yanni in front of Stone. Okay, not Yanni. Let's I give up. I don't know. Rolling Stones. I don't know. Somebody. Anyway, but get all these people performing around the world. And remember, my idea here is that there's no seventh chakra. The seventh chakra is the human mind. The seventh chakra is the spirit that actually links us all together. So the final aspect of this is that by October 28th of 2011, which is actually the end of the Aztec calendar. The Aztec calendar ends where it says balance will be attained between the East and the West, end of control by one soul over another soul, beginning of the universal underworld, February 11th of 2011, and the development of a non-dual cosmic consciousness. Here's what this means also, what it means for us. There's a war inside every single one of you between the East and the West. And what is that war? The war is between the left sides of the brain. We cannot achieve peace on a global level until we achieve that peace within ourselves. Let me tell you how that works. What happens, and this is a lot of what I'm going to talk about tomorrow. We've got a whole day class where we're going to do spiritual survival tools, we're going to do meditations, we're going to do wing activations, we're going to do an activation of the 12 chakras, we're going to do the basis of remote viewing. And here's the challenge, and here's how it works. Gotcha. Here's how it works globally, and here's how it works individually. The right and the brain, the right side of the brain, which controls the left-hand side of the body, and the left side of the brain controls the right side of the body. The left-hand side of the brain, which controls the right side, is primarily male. It's the dominant, aggressive, masculine, aggressive side of the brain. This is the linear part of the brain. This is the western part of the brain. The western part of the brain only thinks in those three dimensions of height, width, and breadth. There's so many feet between you and I. Your hair is kind of brown with frosted highlights. You've got kind of a coral top on. You've got jeans. What I'm doing is I'm and what this side of the brain is doing is simply measuring information. That's all this side of the brain is good for, is measuring height, width, breadth, and a measurement of linear time. So this side of the brain basically understands the essence of mathematics, the essence of geometry, and this side of the brain, being the Western mind, means that the only thing that is important or real to this side of the brain is something that can be quantifiably measured. Does that sound Western to you? So the right-hand side of the brain, which we call the passive feminine submissive, I also call the crazy lady in the purple muumuu running through a field of poppies, mostly, you know, like the lady on the street corner out here. Or I saw some guy in a tutu. Is that guy, did you see the guy in the tutu? Either there's like, he took too much ecstasy or not enough, I think. I'm not sure which. But this side of the brain, which is the passive feminine submissive side of the brain, this side of the brain exists in quantum time. What this side of the brain exists in is that this side of the brain doesn't understand up, down, right, left, or center, can't add 2 plus. This side of the brain exists in a world of symbology, of archetypes, of symbols, of music, of color, of art and dance. This side of the brain is what's excited and ignited by psilocybins, for example, by like mushrooms, by marijuana, by LSD, what have you. Nobody invites their friends over to get stoned and does their taxes, is the bottom line. You know, nobody's like, hey dude, I got some great trigonometry here. Let's try some of this out, man. Oh, that's some heavy algebra. We should play a saxophone. do some equations. So this side of the brain right here deals in specifically the feminine part of the brain, but because it exists in quantum time, this side of the brain knows everything. It knows everything. And that's the basis of remote viewing. And what I did with remote viewing was that I took the military aspect of remote viewing, of how they were teaching it to the CIA and how they were teaching it to the military, and there's one conclusion that I came to that you may or may not share with me, that when the military gets involved, the military's not a charitable, altruistic organization. Do you think? The military doesn't like puppies and little children and grow flowers, does it? When the military teaches you something, it's usually to kill somebody, don't you think? So what I did is I took that and I combined it with all the things that I learned in India and in Nepal and when I lived with the Dalai Lama's residence in Dharamsala, and all of this Tibetan Buddhism I took and I put into the Western aspect and came up with a system of remote viewing that is one of the best. I mean, my remote viewers, just, they totally kick butt. I'd put them up against anybody in the world. Like my Anna's jumping up now back there. Some of my viewing kids back there. So combining this together, where does this come from? The aspect is this side of the brain is the constant critic. All right, this side of the brain is the guy that I call the guy in the toilet on the back of your head. This is the guy that's like, what are you doing? You're outside, you're playing tennis, right? This guy goes, I don't know why we're playing tennis. We got so much work to do. You're playing, I don't know. My inner conscience actually sounds like an old Jewish man. I have no idea. But he's like, what are you doing? You should be inside. And then I go, okay, I got to go to work. And then I go inside. I'm sitting in front of my computer. You know what he says? This sucks. It's nice outside. We should be out playing, doing something else. What am I doing sitting in front of the computer? I'm in hell. So then I go outside and play. So the idea is that once we quiet that inner voice, once we meld everything together, once we combine the East and the asking the phantom, the quantum and the quantitative together, we have peace. And once that occurs within us, then we achieve peace throughout the world and throughout the planet. Now, building up to 2012, I've got like 3 minutes left here, so let's recap here. Let me just recap in the moments we have. The recap is, we want to cure cancer, here's the BrioMed.com, here's IBC Hospital if you have people that are sick, okay? The Escazole is the blue scorpion venom, okay, guys. Tequila, you get stung. All right, comes up, doesn't have cancer anymore. Oh, let's milk those little scorpions. Drink the stuff, okay, and then you're good. All right, now, we talked about the financial markets. Okay, the financial markets. Hey, invest money with me. Give me money, I'll make you more. Okay, there you go. Now, I'm a citizen of Melchizedek, but wait, there's more. Okay, there we go. We've got the driver's license. We've got the diplomatic idea. Hey, the guy stopped me at the airport. Oh, well, go right this way, sir. No strip search for you. Okay, there we go. So now we've got Melchizedek. Then the lady asked the question about the secured party creditor. Okay, you have a strawman legis. If you're a strawman legis, the government can't draft you and send you off to foreign land to kill people you don't like. Okay, where were we? Then the financial markets, George Bush, give me a pony, kill Anna Nicole. All right, then we've got, then he gives the State of the Union, there's some Whoppers and I'm the Burger King. Okay, there we go. And let me see the Burger King. Then we talked about the money, then we talked about the gold, we talked about the financial markets. Okay, we'll talk about 2012, 2007. Talk about the Germans, okay, a guy like Hitler, okay, in Europe. And then he comes along, takes everything over, the dollar collapses at some point. Stock market, remember, it goes up like a Jenga tower. Stock market goes up like a Jenga tower, goes to 13,000. But wait, we don't have to worry about the stock market. We just give Sean our money, and he's investing our money for us. So hey, now I'm rich, and I'm happy, and I'm a movie star. All right, 2007. Let me slow down here just to give you some other dates that I think are fascinating. Coming up, once again, this year, let me give you some specific predictions. All right, people in Seattle, this is what I want to get out there. I want to get this on tape. Seattle is in a great deal of danger this year. And it's the only time I've ever agreed with Pat Robertson. I can't believe he said it. After I did some meditations on this, there will be a series of very major earthquakes in the Pacific Northwest, creating tsunami activity. I don't think it'll wipe out the city, but there will be a great deal of challenges due to storms, due to earthquakes, and due to tsunami activity along the Aleutian Islands, and actually waves coming down from Alaska. So the Pacific Northwest and Seattle is in great danger this year, number one. Number two, the stock market, as I said, will go to 13,000. Watch. Huge reworking of the markets. We're going through another six-month phase here. We went through a six-month phase from May through approximately November, and I predicted in late November of last year we would see an economic implosion. That happened on the world currency markets. We're in another six-month phase. So those of you that are in the stock markets are involved economically, watch the last 2 weeks from May 15th to approximately the 1st of June for the markets for a big nosedive in the markets. You can see another big spike down, one last big spike up, and I think by the fall of this year you're going to see a major, major collapse in the global financial markets, along with the US dollar by the fall, and a huge shift away from the US dollar to the euro. That's later this year. Moving up into 2008, talking about the presidential, I meant to ask this gentleman's question again. I talked about George Bush, okay? When I made my original projections on Bush, when I predicted he'd be president back in 1997, and again in 98, all the way through, I said that there were three periods of time, and you can check this out yourself. Pluto hit 7 degrees Sagittarius three times this year. We just went through one transit just over the last 3 weeks. There's another one coming up in May, and another one coming up in the fall. I believe, I don't have the paper in front of me, but I believe it's September. There is a very distinct possibility that, and I hope this does not happen, and I pray for his safety, that the President of the United States may be assassinated or die this year. The reason I say that, shut up, don't say that. It's one of those things where he's the leader of our country, and we do respect him, you know, because he is the leader of our country. It's the office that you respect, not the man that's in the office. So, when this happened before in 2003, I had the gentleman pointed out, I had the Secret Service come to my house. I said, these are the transits. This goes directly over the Sibley chart in the United States, which is the point of assassination in the US chart. It has never happened before in US history because Pluto's rotation is 242 plus years. I said it to the Secret Service guys, and I said, the specific one will be the worst in December of 2003. They freaked out because in England at that time. They spent $150 million protecting him at that time. I then said, if Bush survives 2003, he would win the election in 2004 by a landslide, specifically, and of course he won by 4 million votes. He only won by like 16 electoral votes, but he won the popular vote by 4 million, considering he lost the popular vote by almost 1.5 million in 2000, but won in the Electoral College, as predicted. This year, once again, we've just gone through a transit. If you have astrological calendars, look at where Pluto goes through 27 degrees. Because Pluto is right now at galactic center, approximately. And so it'll do that. It's gone through it once. It's going to go retrograde and back up through it. And then it goes through one last big kind of roundhouse punch where it reaches back to Cincinnati for it, and boom. That's going to be the really, really dark part for Bush. This could be a political assassination as well, because physical assassinations and political assassinations look the same. The only thing where I was wrong in my predictions on Clinton was that I saw what looked like a predict an impeachment. I also said that if it was just Monica, that he would skate through it. But I said that Al Gore would run, and I saw him running as President of the United States because I didn't see Bill Clinton anywhere in the equation. And for the first time, Clinton was asked to bow out. Clinton was in Asia most of the time when Gore was running. So my psychic projection of it actually never saw Clinton actually involved in the process. So anyway, the bottom line of this whole thing is, I have said before that I did not see Bush actually finishing presidency, but I never saw Cheney as president either. I also still think that Jeb Bush has some kind of destiny or something that's going to go on in the 2008 election. Right now, the front runner for the Republicans will be Mitt Romney, and the front runner, obviously, for the Democrats is Hillary Clinton. Hillary Clinton has a gigantic political machine with a huge amount of money, and the only way that she will be president of the United States, and the reason I say this is because nobody south of the Mason-Dixon line in the land we call America, not America, but America, nobody in America, everybody in America thinks that Hillary Clinton is a devil-worshipping, baby-eating lesbian, and that's the bottom line. Not my opinion, but it's what they think. And if you've ever seen Hillary Clinton debate, she's not very good at it. And so when she gets up against somebody like Mitt Romney, and the reason Mitt Romney, I think, is going to be the front runner, he's Mormon, by the way, which is kind of freaky. My wife's their queen, of the Mormons. He's Mormon, but he's already met with Falwell. He's already met with Pat Robertson. He's basically saying, look, we have a disagreement. You fundamentalists don't think us Mormons or Christians like you are, but I'm the closest you're going to get to a faith-based candidate. Romney is a Republican governor in the most Democratic state in the Union, which is Massachusetts. Romney is also known as Mr. Fix-It, which means when he comes in 2008, because he fixed the Olympics in 2002, he fixed the state of Massachusetts, he's going to come in and say, look, I can fix the economy, I can fix the war, and people will believe him. Mitt Romney right now is a front runner. I'm still telling you, Jeb Bush is a dark horse player in there somewhere, and there may be the possibility that when Dick Cheney actually is, if he doesn't get the war off the ground and Cheney loses his job because of the Valerie Plame thing, that there may be the possibility that Bush will turn to Jeb as his vice presidential candidate. I'm telling you, he's just out there, and he's just sitting around doing nothing. By the way, did anybody see the speech where Bush gave where he was crying on YouTube?
Yeah.
With you know why he was crying? He was crying because after the currency collapsed, the lost $2.3 trillion in a naked short on the U.S. dollar. That's why he was crying. He was like, my son, Jeff, we lost so much money. Ah! That's why he was crying. All right, that's 2008. Let's move beyond 2008. There's the only reason I'm not giving a solid projection on 2008 like I have with every other election is that there's a huge amount of chaos in 2008. There are natural catastrophes. There is economic chaos. There are riots. There are foreign troops on U.S. soil at that time. There's just bad, nasty things that go on. 2010, in my predictions, is when the next big quake happens in Los Angeles. So the quake actually happens in the Santa Monica Bay and actually creates a great deal of destruction along a line through Hollywood, through Beverly Hills, and creates a tsunami, a very small tidal wave or so that causes a great deal of damage. I say 2010, but every time I see the quake that actually hits Los Angeles, what I see specifically is I see a tower that's been built in downtown LA that has an angel with a flaming sword on top of the tower just to the west of downtown Los Angeles that's under construction at the time the quake hits. I also see there's some kind of major international event that's occurring, which I believe to be the Olympics in Los Angeles at that time. So one of two things will happen. Either the Olympics in London will be moved for some reason due to terrorism or destruction or something happening in England, which means that there's some emergency plan to put the 2012 Olympics in LA, or Los Angeles gets the 2016 Olympics, and there's all this building. There's a retrofit of the Coliseum, and there's all this building and the tower and the whole thing. And in the preparation for that is the big quake that hits Los Angeles sometime in the 2010 timeframe. Leading up into 2012, right now the sun is going through what we call cycle 24. Cycle 23 never ended. The polarities of the sun shifted. Null period in which 23 shifted into cycle 24, which means now the solar cycle is building so that the largest solar cycle in our history, or the history of counted history, if you will, of our awareness of history, occurs sometime between 2012 and approximately 2014, coming up into that period of time with the largest solar activity and massive solar flares. And of course, the unique thing about the year 2012 for Los Angeles, the West Coast, and whatever, is that in 2012, May of 2012, there is a massive solar eclipse, a complete solar eclipse that cuts across the western part of the United States and aligns directly over Chichen Itza. And for the first time in 26,000 years, the Pleiades, the sun, and the moon will be directly aligned over the Great Pyramid of Chichen Itza as the serpent Quetzalcoatl is actually coming down in the shadow of the steps. In June of that year, also I think on the 4th of June of 2012, Venus actually transits across the sun again, empowering the feminine energy once more. And then on December 21st of 2012, again for the first time in 26,000 years, the sun aligns directly with 27 degrees Sagittarius directly at galactic center, which means the sun aligns with the ball court directly at the Mayan ball court. What they're trying to tell you is that at that time, one person will no longer be able to enslave another because we will be in a state of total truth. At that time, we get the core synthesis of all is one, life has purpose, God is love, and we all live happily ever after. The end. Thank you. Thanks for coming, guys. Hopefully we'll see you tomorrow at the thing, okay? Faultless King.
Did you remember the end of the fourth Reich?
The end of the fourth Reich?
No, the EU is the fourth Reich. Can we save them from the third Reich? Who's going to save us from the fourth Reich?
I don't know. I'm not so sure the United States isn't all part of it, but it's...
Well, they are. That's what I mean. They are. You know, they're being taken over from the fourth Reich. So it's kind of like, how long is this going to last before you save the fourth Reich stuff?
Well, according to the Mayan calendar, they come to a scene of power and it lasts a year.
And then they lose power.
The first phase was the Roman Empire. That was the fall of the collapse of the Roman Empire, the Dark Age. The next one was from 32.
next one's going to be from 2000. It's going to be a very, very brief period of time. So it's from approximately 07 to 08. That's what they call the National Planetary and Galactic Day. So we're in the fifth day leading up to this period of time, up to, you know, there's the Aztec calendar. I'm going to explain this. The Aztec calendar, which ends in October 28th, 2011, the reason it ends then is the Aztec calendar ends with conception. The Aztec calendar literally ends with, like, the sperm hitting the egg, so to speak, whereas the Mayan calendar ends with birth in 2012. So something happens at that point where it begins to beat in the heart, and then 2012 is when this new consciousness is then birth. It doesn't mean there's going to be an age of peace, though. I think what it's going to be more like, it's going to be sort of a Star Wars type of thing where it spawns new warriors, if you will, people with amazing sort of matrix-like abilities, and they're the ones that are the force of angels, if you will. That